Hey men, welcome back to Men's Bible Study for the fall of 2022. I hope you're enjoying getting started here in the Gospel of Matthew. I mean, what an amazing book we have here. The good news about Jesus Christ according to his eyewitness member of the original 12 disciples, Matthew. That's amazing. Now, as you've already heard, Matthew's intended audience was his own people, the Jews. And his book is all about the life and ministry of his Messiah, Jesus, who firsthand called him out of his former life because he was what his people would probably consider a turncoat, a traitor, a despised tax collector. And yet, the Lord Jesus turned him into a devoted disciple. And as tradition holds, Matthew would die as a martyr for proclaiming the good news about Jesus Christ, the Messiah that his people had been waiting for. So this lesson right here is going to cover the second half of lesson number one in your Life Change study book. Today we're going to take a look at chapter two of Matthew. So in this video, what I'm hoping to do is three things here. One, I want to give you a little bit of context and background of what's going on here. Number two, I want to give you a few things to look for in the text as you study chapter two. And number three, to provide you with hopefully some useful applications and takeaways. So let's start with a little background and context. All right, so given the subject that we're studying today, I thought it'd be appropriate for us to enjoy a little musical underscore of We Three Kings, that famous Christmas carol. No, we're not actually not going to do that. No, Matthew chapter 2 covers the very, very familiar Christmas time story of the appearance of the wise men, their journey to worship the newborn king, their secret exit back to their homeland, Jesus' family's escape to Egypt, and subsequent return back to their hometown of Nazareth in Galilee. Now, it can't be stated too strongly that much of what we think we know about this passage is probably wrong. Yeah. Now, I don't mean to ruin anybody's Christmas here, but we definitely have to approach this text with some fresh eyes, with the awareness that we're bringing with us a bunch of assumptions, a bunch of presuppositions, and even some pretty concrete imagery about who these wise men were and even what they looked like. So let's do a little Q&A here to see if we can't compare the truth with fiction. All right, let's start with We Three Kings. So here's the question. How many wise men were there? And the answer we think of course, is three, right? Probably not. It's actually highly unlikely that there were three of them. All we really know from the text is that there were more than one. So there could have been two. There could have been five, 12, 21. Nobody knows. Where do we get this idea of three wise men? Where does that come from? Well, it comes from the three gifts presented to Jesus in verse 11, gold, frankincense, and myrrh. But we don't even know that these were three gifts, only three types of gifts presented to Jesus. So the next question is this. These wise men were some sort of a king, right? I mean, We Three Kings. That's what the song says. So the answer says, that we think of, says, well, the song says We Three Kings, so they must be some kind of kings. Sorry, but no. No, they were not kings. The Magi were likely not kings themselves. Instead, they were important advisors to kings, emperors, and the like. But they were also a little bit more than that. The word used here in verse 1 in the original Greek for wise men is the word magi. And that's a term we find in early historical records from the Babylonian and Persian empires. In fact, we see the appearance of the Magi in the second chapter of the book of Daniel, serving as advisors to King Nebuchadnezzar of Babylon. These, of course, are the very same Babylonians who conquered Judah in 586 BC, taking many Jews away into forced exile, as many of you know from your study in Isaiah last year. So then you have the empire next door, the Medo-Persians, later who conquered those Babylonians. They brought in a much more tolerant empire, at least as far as the Jews were concerned, that eventually allowed the Jews to return to their homeland about 70 years later under the leadership of Ezra and Nehemiah. So these Magi then, no doubt, had at least some exposure to the Jewish scriptures within which they'd read about the coming Messiah. So these Magi, as I said, were not kings, but were an important part of the ruling class of these magnificent empires, serving as a type of priest, advisor, diplomat, religious leaders. And what they did was they kind of combined Zoroastrianism, astrology, even forms of magic in order to understand the present and to forecast the future. Okay, last thing for background and context. Question, when did the Magi come? Well, the answer we often think of is when Jesus was born, right? Nope, sorry, but the wise men don't historically belong to the manger scene. They weren't there. And again, I'm sorry if I'm ruining anybody's Christmas here. There's actually been some time elapsed between chapter 1 and chapter 2. What are the clues that we have for this? Well, we see that the wise men told Herod in a secret meeting exactly when the star appeared, signifying the birth of the king of the Jews. So Herod later makes the decision to have all the boys, 2 and under, to be executed, as we can read in this passage. So this tells us something about the time frame that Herod was told Jesus was born within. In other words, Jesus could have been born up to 2 years before the Magi's visit. Also, we learn in verse 11 that the Magi came to visit Jesus in the house where he was staying, which is obviously a different place than the manger or the cave where Jesus was born. Okay, so that's enough about the background and context. Now, let me turn your attention towards some things to look for in the text here. So there's actually a lot to draw your attention here, So I'll just pick a few select things. Okay, let's look at verse 3. The text says, when Herod the king heard this, that is, that the wise men said they had come to worship the king of the Jews who was just born, he was troubled, and all Jerusalem with him. Now that's an intriguing verse. What's fascinating here is that these wise men were not just some random visitors who showed up barely noticed or were considered some strange foreigners with a little understanding of the Jews. Clearly, their arrival here in Jerusalem was a big deal, and their credibility was apparently unquestionable. They had so much credibility, in fact, that Herod decided to kill off an entire generation of boys in a small town based solely upon their word. I mean, even a bloodthirsty tyrant like Herod wouldn't do such a heinous thing unless he believed their credibility and authority was airtight. That's just fascinating. So the text says that all of Jerusalem was troubled along with Herod. Now, this word, troubled, means unsettled, even agitated. So the appearance of these Magi upset a lot of people's apple carts. A lot of people were really freaked out about the appearance of these guys. And these were most likely the ruling class who were upset. Now, some theologians, some historians think that this upsetness was because Herod and his court feared invasion from the east, and they saw the Magi's appearance as a potential prelude to war. And Herod had actually built up impressive fortifications on his eastern border. Excuse me. But honestly, this is unlikely, because Herod was a Roman-appointed king of Judea. Any attack on Judea would incur the wrath of the superpower of the time, the mighty Roman Empire. So I think this theory is pretty doubtful. Most likely is the fact that these impressive Magi had just told a tyrannical King Herod, who, of course, wasn't even a Jew himself, that the rightful king of the Jews had already been born in Bethlehem right under his nose, and his own court advisors, the chief priest, the Sanhedrin, they didn't even know anything about it. So can you just imagine how upsetting this news would be? I mean, if you know anything about tyrannical dictators, you know that the people around him were wondering, okay, whose head is going to roll for this unthinkable oversight and mistake? Now, let's fast forward to verse 11. Let's focus on the three gifts: gold, frankincense, and myrrh. These are really interesting gifts. Now, the gift of gold is a kingly gift. This gift signified Jesus' position or title as king. And what's fascinating here is that these foreigners, these magi, are apparently the only ones in all of Israel to actually understand who Jesus is. They're the only ones worshiping him as king. That's pretty astounding when you think about it. Let's look at gift number two, the frankincense, aka incense. This gift is symbolic of Jesus' status as high priest. You see, the incense, that incense was the same type that was burning constantly within the temple as a site of consecration and worship and intercession. So this gift of frankincense speaks to Jesus as our intercessor, the one who bridges the gap between God and man, our great high priest described so eloquently in the book of Hebrews. And the final gift is myrrh. Myrrh was a spice that was used for anointing the dead. It's used in burial preparation to overwhelm the smell of decay before a body is laid to rest. So this gift is symbolic of Jesus' status as our sacrifice, our Lamb of God. So Jesus is not only our intercessor who bridges the gap between God and man, he also, of course, died the death that we owe so we could have eternal life with him. King, high priest, sacrifice. Three gifts actually presented by God to man who presented his one and only son as a gift to us. All right, here's a couple more things to take note of in the text. Fast forward to verses 12 and 13. It's interesting to note that God once again intervenes directly in this moment in history by appearing to the Magi in a dream firsthand. And then in verse 13, it's an angel who appears to Joseph in a dream, warning him to flee to Egypt with his family. And again, an angel of the Lord would reappear to Joseph sometime later in Egypt to return to Israel in verse 19. Obviously, the care of his one and only son is very important to him, or important enough that God himself is appearing to these magi and sending an angel to appear to Joseph to ensure the course of events plays out according to his perfect plan. Okay, one last thing to take note of here. In verse 15, 18, and 23, we see how Matthew is demonstrating how Jesus is the long-awaited Messiah to his people, the Jews, as well as to us today. In verse 15, it's the Hosea 11:1 reference. Originally a reference to the Exodus, but as with so many other prophecies, it has a double meaning. And it refers to the early life of Jesus, that he and his family would come up out of Egypt. Then we have verse 18, which connects the dots between two events. Herod's slaughter of the innocent boys of Bethlehem, and centuries before, the Babylonian army taking captives from the ancient town of Ramah into exile to Babylon. We can read about that in Jeremiah 40, verses 1 and 2. Rachel here is the personification of the mothers of Israel mourning for their children as they're being carried away. Again, Matthew is telling us that this event, the slaughter of the innocents, was also foretold by Jeremiah. Lastly, we've got verse 23. So read that. Matthew here asserts that Jesus would be called a Nazarene. Interesting. So some scholars believe that he's referring to Isaiah 11:1, which uses the Hebrew word neser, meaning root. While others surmise that the use of the term Nazarene here means someone in the common vernacular who is despised in Matthew's time and place. So this is like a phrase Matthew's using that's everyday speech and slang, which of course has many Old Testament references, including Isaiah 53, among many others, about how Jesus was despised. Okay, now, how about some takeaways and some applications? The first one of these that jumps out of the text is the good news about Jesus, the gospel, is for everybody. It's for everybody. The Magi are a powerful symbol of the fact that the gospel, the good news about Jesus, is actually for the entire world. It's not just for the Jews. Again, it's ironic and it's really kind of crazy that God had become flesh among his anointed people, the Jews, and literally the only people in the whole country actually worshiping him as king were these magi, these astrologers, magicians, powerful, influential advisors to kings and emperors. It's just, it's really amazing. So God is really the God of all people, all nations, for all times. And his gospel, this good news, his kingdom, it's still spreading like wildfire all over the world today, especially in places like Africa and South America, but even throughout the Islamic world and in places like you'd never expect, like communist China. So the people in your life who you think or presuppose might not have the slightest interest in God, they just might be the ones who are most receptive to him, if given the chance. And you might be that chance for them. So I urge you to pray for that least likely person in your life to receive Christ as their Lord and Savior. And pray for that opportunity to answer for that hope that lies within you. Have that conversation with that least likely person in your life. All right, second application or takeaway. God takes the good, the bad, and the ugly in our lives, and he mysteriously allows and uses all of it to accomplish his will. For example, in this passage, we read about Herod's slaughter of these innocent young boys. Now, this is not part of the Christmas narrative that we find on any Christmas card. No. This was a heinous, awful act by a ruthless despot that undoubtedly crushed the hopes and dreams of many families for many generations. And yet, this atrocity was allowed and even used by God to accomplish his plan of redemption. So here's the thing. You might be facing some inexplicably difficult and even awful things in your life today, most of which can only be explained by the fact that we live in a sinful, fallen, broken world. And yet, our God, your God, is at work fulfilling the plans for your life and the lives of so many others. He's working out his redemptive plan for all of humankind according to his sovereign will. A lot of which makes little to no sense to us. So the takeaway, even when life is inexplicably hard and it makes no sense, God is still sovereign and he's using everything to accomplish his purposes and his will for your life and for mine. Here's the last of our takeaways. Jesus is the Messiah that the entire world is looking for. Matthew, as we'll see throughout his gospel here, is going to take great pains to demonstrate over and over again that all the predictions and the prophecies about Jesus found throughout the Old Testament, they point to just one person. That's Jesus Christ. So this should embolden and strengthen our faith and trust in him, because literally only one human being could possibly fulfill all these prophecies and predictions about the Messiah, which in and of itself is absolutely mind-boggling. So the takeaway here is we can have great confidence that Jesus was who he said he was, God in the flesh, who dwelt among us, who offered himself as ransom for our atonement, rose again from the grave, and defeated death and sin forever. Who also said he'd return one day to bring us home and usher in a new age where every knee will bow, every tongue will confess that he is Lord. Now that should put some pep in your step. That should put a huge smile on your face, because as bad as this world is getting, we know that a new one is coming. And that assurance, that confidence, can only come from one place: a rock solid knowledge that Jesus was who he said he was. So I pray that this knowledge steals your faith. It makes it unshakable, immovable, and that it transforms you from the inside out. So men, I pray that you have an amazing year studying this incredible book of Matthew and diving deep into the riches of God's Word.